referee, Richard Steele, brings them together. And Weaver is the man who comes charging after Doakes to start this one off. Doakes forced a counter punch early in the round, but doing so beautifully. A good left thrown by Mike Weaver. Now an assault by Doakes. Pounding Weaver as they're going to try to settle this thing in the first few seconds, it would appear. There's a left. Two lefts catch Weaver. Weaver, hurt by the second one, takes a right from Doakes. Doakes teeing off on him on the ropes just above us. Weaver started this. He flew out at Michael Doakes, but has paid the price ever since.
I felt that right away. They're both going to look to get it over with, and they both don't like each other, and they're looking bombs go away. And the one that lands with the flusher bomb is going to score the knockout.
Weaver was shaken by a couple of snapping left hooks thrown by Michael Doakes in the first 30 seconds.
But remember, the puncher is Weaver. Doakes is an arm banger. He doesn't let his whole full body go into the punch.
They look tired already as the pace slackens off a little bit now. No ring movement on the part of these two, leaning at each other, ready to pound away.
When you let punches like that go like that, Don, you got to ease up a little bit and say, wait a minute now, because in boxing, there is no extra gas tank. You got to look to go. If you're going to go to 15, you got to be ready to go then.
They are midway in the round, which means this rematch has lasted longer than the first fight at the stage.
There's no pleasantness going on in the ring. They're hitting each other in a break. They're throwing low blows. The Marquess of Queensbury rules is not being adhered to.
Not before or during this fight. No love lost here. Weaver and Doakes. Very open resentment toward each other for very obvious reasons. The events of last December right here in Las Vegas.
Very important first round because they're trying to establish the dominance right now. They're both landing low punches.
Doakes getting a good combination through a solid left thrown by Michael Doakes. He's getting the best of it here.
The faster hands,
up early.
Faster hands, Don, are definitely Doakes. The puncher is Mike Weaver.
Very interesting round. Started off furiously. They went to sleep for a while, came back. But the dominant pattern has been the left hand, certainly, of Michael Doakes that has scored time and time again and has hurt Weaver a couple of times.
Those body shots are not doing Michael Doakes any good either, Don. He hit him a real good body shot, Mike Weaver, and landed right down to that soft part of his belly.
That's right. That body is soft, and that will wear him down. That is Weaver's plan, to take this as long as he can, and he will gain momentum as he goes along. Just seconds remaining now in the first round. They get through round one. They've gone almost three times as long as the first bout back in December. An exciting first round between Mike Weaver and Michael Doakes in the rematch. And they stung each other, both men looking for the knockout blow. A left by Weaver, a left by Michael Doakes in that exchange. Then later in the round, the long looping left hand by Michael Doakes, the chopping right by Mike Weaver effective, landing punches almost at the same time.
When she knows like evil
with Bengay.
Rain. Rain dance. And you won't have to wax so often.
The company that has. Because nothing sparks like a champion. Guaranteed.
The second round in Las Vegas underway. Weaver with an obvious advantage in the first round.
The heat. Weaver's accustomed to having been in South Africa. It's a very, very hot climate. And he's trained most of his time in California, Las Vegas. So he's accustomed to this heat. I don't know how the heat's going to treat Michael Doakes.
It may not do him very much good. Michael Doakes, remember, has never gone past 10 rounds. Weaver coming on now in the second round.
There goes that jab that Mike Weaver never used before. It's going to be a very interesting thing because he's already bloodied Mike Doakes' nose. The other interesting thing is a very slow ring because they painted that Budweiser sign in there and they use lead paint. So you may notice them during a fight where the feet will be sticking, but it makes no difference to either of these fights because they don't bounce around.
There is evidence of blood, as Angelo Dundee said, from the left nostril of Michael Doakes. Weaver appears to certainly have regained his composure here in the second round.
Well, that jab's a very important weapon for Weaver to set up his hooks in his right hand. He didn't use it naturally in the first round, didn't have a chance to.
Oaks, the outstanding amateur, turning professional, winning this title here a few months ago, trying to hang on to it here.
They're both out there to do one thing, take each one out of there. Michael's making an old type mistake, an amateur mistake, grabbing at his trunks and trying to pull him up. But maybe a couple of those shots are really hurting him downstairs.
Doak's making Weaver pay as Weaver plods in on him. Now a combination by Weaver. Toe-to-toe, away they go again. You get the feeling this can't last terribly long.
Well, you don't know with these kind of fights. The pace they're going could very well go all night long. He's going to be a factor. I think the Weaver will take the heat better than anybody else, Dom, because I think Doakes is not ready for a hot time fight in the old town tonight.
30 seconds left of the second round. Certainly more muscle tone evident on Weaver's body than we see on Michael Doakes tonight.
He's got muscles coming out of his toenails, Dom.
Superbly conditioned for this. Takes that wicked left hook from Doakes again. Leans on him. Works to the body. Throws a good right, Weaver does. And body shots from Doakes. The overhand right thrown by Michael Doakes.
Milwaukee this week on ABC's Monday Night Baseball.
This grudge rematch continues.
And if looks could hurt, when Mike Weaver looked at Doakes walking back to the corner, he would have scored a knockdown.
Oh, they are scowling at each other into the third round. Doakes certainly showing more respect for Weaver than he did in round one. Weaver coming on more and more, and you get the feeling he's building confidence as he goes.
What Doak's trying to do is trying to lure him into counterpunchers, and Weaver's trying to offset him with the left jab, which is a good maneuver. We go to left hand, set up everything.
This has the makings of an excellent matchup, as they will finally decide which really is the better of the two men. Obviously, 63 seconds didn't do it. We're going to find out here tonight. Hope you're enjoying it wherever you're looking in this evening from Las Vegas.
Those trunks of Doakes has got a little too tight on him. He keeps trying to stretch him. It'd be a mistake to be grabbing on him because he could get nailed.
Snap three rights, missed the last one, aimed at Weaver's head. Chopping right thrown by Mike Weaver. Head to head they go.
I was talking to Jerry Cutsia. He said, boy, that Mike Weaver can punch. Mike Doakes keeps throwing a low blow, that's going to hit him in the kneecap, because they've been hitting each other low, both guys.
Weaver winced a few seconds ago. We're midway on the round. He caught one from Doakes. Good left thrown by Mike Weaver. He's scoring well now with either hand. Coming from off the ropes.
Weaver's very dangerous in close because he throws the shorter punches. So Michael Doakes would do well not to get staked around those clinches, because he's going to get nailed.
No question, the greater hand speed belongs to Weaver.
But Don, you notice when Doakes throws punches, he puts both feet together, nullifying any power in his punches. They're straight across, instead of keeping his left foot in the pocket. You'll notice when he gets in the clinches, both feet are together.
A lot of solid blows, no devastating blows so far between these two. Certainly, as it goes on, Weaver has the experience and endurance.
Well, we're going to find out this fight who's the better conditioned guy, because it's going to be survival of the fittest.
By less than 30 seconds remaining here in this third round. The fight just about even at this point.
See the feet come up? The
yep.
2 feet?
5 seconds to go in the third round.
That's a chance for glory, but the stakes are too high on Fantasy Island.
Tonight.
Round four.
Michael Dokes is going back to the corner blowing. Now, they shouldn't be blowing. Third round. Now, I hope to God that, you know, he realized what a title means to a fighter.
There was always the danger that it happened too easily for him in December, and that would affect his training coming into this rematch.
No, there's no shortcuts in boxing. You got to do it the right way or not do it at all.
Don Chevrier along with Angelo Dundee, the veteran fight trainer at ringside here in the fourth round, scheduled for 15, the WBA heavyweight championship at stake. Michael Dokes, Mike Weaver.
I tell you, they're looking to hit each other with a sucker shot, and they're trying to work into it. Weaver is more perceptive with a left jab. I think Dokes are trying to take a breather. I think it's a mistake.
You can't take time off in here. There appears to be less and less sting from Dokes' punches as we go along, more and more from Mike Weaver. Halfway of the fourth round. Remember, the line was, the longer it goes, the more it favors Mike Weaver. Angelo Dundee called Weaver to win it before this fight began.
Well, it's not over. I mean, you know, I've been wrong so many times it frightens me. But I felt all things taken into consideration, and Michael Dokes thinking he can get the guy out of there anytime he wants to was a mistake, because two things don't happen the same time. Lightning don't strike twice in boxing.
A minute left, and this is the fourth round. Angelo Dundee, you have said so often, it's not what happens to a man after he wins. A good right, two rights by Weaver. Left hook by Dokes blocked. Now Dokes counter-punching very well. We'll get back to that point of yours in a moment as the action picks up here. Chopping right hand thrown by Weaver, missing with the uppercut. Dokes missing with the right, then the left. Less than 30 seconds to go on the round, but it's not what happens to a man when he wins. It's how he reacts after he loses.
That's right.
And Weaver's
gotta,
coming through very well.
You got to be able to handle it. You got to be able to realize what it means to you.
All right, there's a caution now from the referee Richard Steele to Dokes about one of many low blows we have seen tonight. Less than 10 seconds remaining in this, the fourth round. And that'll take care of round four. Round underway. As Angelo Dundee stated earlier, Dokes backpedaling now, hoping to trap Weaver. Starts some counter-punching. He's done that effectively. That was a good right thrown by Mike Weaver.
That left hook really hurt.
Yep.
The right wasn't that dangerous, but the left hook to the body really was dangerous. And what they've been doing, they're putting a lot of ice water down Michael Dokes' trunks, because he's really blowing right now, and he's walking back to his corner like it's the last mile. There's no reason for him, because he's a young kid, and I'm surprised the way he's reacting.
Just 24 years of age. The heat certainly taking more of a toll on him. He's in here at 223. heavier than he wanted to be. Weaver at 218.5, as we have stated, looks superbly conditioned for this rematch.
I tell you, if all don't go well tonight for Michael Dokes, I guarantee he won't have Dom Perignon and whiskey for the pressmen when they come into his press headquarters. Because they tell me he lives a real good style. But you can't do that as a fighter. You got to live the Canstein type of style.
He's a gourmet cook, Dokes is. Maybe paying the price for such a hobby right now, although we have a long way to go yet. But again, that could be the problem for Dokes the longer this fight continues. He is in the role of a backpedaling counterpuncher much of the way now in this fifth round.
Michael's fighting Dokes. Michael Dokes fighting the right kind of fight. Backing off, giving him mangles, but where he can't put too much power in his punches, making him reach. So Michael Dokes is fighting a good fight right now. The kind of fight he has to fight to beat Mike Weaver.
The first time, some 5 months ago, it was all over in 63 seconds. Weaver caught flat-footed, was down once. Referee Joey Curtis finally stopped the fight. A minute to go in this fifth round. Weaver thought it was unfair. He said he wasn't hurt and could have continued. But of course, after ring deaths that preceded that bout here only a month before, the referee was being very, very cautious. That's the rematch, which you're watching right now. Trace of blood around the nostrils of Michael Dokes that has been there for the last three or four rounds. Less than 25 seconds to go here in the fifth.
Weaver's got to pick up the pace. He just caught a thumb in his left eye.
Two good jabs thrown by Dokes with the left hand. Both got through. Round five at an end.
Tomorrow, a showdown for the lead.
Sixth round underway in Las Vegas.
Weaver, when he went back to his corner, was complaining to his corner that he's getting thumbed. I don't see anybody go over to the referee and tell him he's getting thumbed. Because when that happens, you got to go over and tell the referee and caution him.
You picked it up in that fifth round. Weaver took the thumb in the eye. Again, Dokes using that jab, backs out of the way of the right body punch thrown by Weaver. It was Mike Weaver who, against Johnny Tate, needed a knockout of the 15th round to win and got one. Dropping Tate flat on his face to win that one.
See, it's very interesting, Don. We're backing up, fighting counterfight, which in the other guy's fighting with aggression. Now, this is an interesting point for the judges. Who's winning the round? Because aggression is Weaver. Counterpunching is Dokes. Now, maybe one good shot in this type of a round could be the answer of who won the round.
It depends on your scoring philosophy, I would think.
Yes.
As to how you approach a fight, how you go about scoring it.
I wouldn't want to be a judge, Don, because it's a very intricate, tough job. But they got some great ones. These three judges they have tonight are real good ones.
Aaron Letterman from New York, Larry Hazard from New Jersey, and Jerry Roth from Nevada are the three ringside judges. The three knockdown rule is in effect. Midway in the sixth round, we have had no knockdowns to this point.
Michael Weaver's waiting a little too long. He's not going to hit nobody trying to set up for one punch. He's got to go off his jab, let the shots go. And what Dokes is doing is keeping them off balance. That's the whole battle plan is working.
Good left thrown by Weaver there. A minute to go in the sixth round now. There is question. He has to go 10 or longer as to how much stamina Dokes will have. Remember, 10 rounds has been his limit so far.
Michael Dove still looks to grab his trunks. He's going to get nailed with a left hook one time because he grabbed his trunks with his right hand.
You're right. That is an amateur trick, which could backfire on him. 15 seconds to go on the round. Weaver just keeps on coming, and Dopes ever so slowly backpedaling in a circular fashion around this Las Vegas ring. A chopping right by Weaver at the bell to end round number six.
This is the one.
They approach the midway point, round seven, and this bout is still too close to call.
I'm not afraid to take a pick. The guy with the red glove.
Dokes continues to back around and flick out that left, which has been a very effective punch for him, the jab as he goes. He got two in right there on Weaver.
Michael Dolphin grabbing the ropes every chance he got. He's looking to rest in those clinches. It's dangerous to try to rest in a clinch so you're liable to catch your punch. What he's doing is you keep moving. Maybe the stamina's not there to keep moving because it takes a lot of effort to keep moving.
He's not exactly spreading around this ring, but the movement has got to wear him down.
Sure. It's easier going forward than going back. Different
Weaver.
Types of muscle down, different time of movement.
It is so hot here that it's taking a toll on everybody, certainly these two men in the ring, but more so on Michael Dokes, it would appear. 90 degrees at fight time here in Las Vegas tonight.
Referee almost got himself knocked down that last clinch because Weaver let go with a shot. He almost wasn't away of it.
Referee Richard Steele has his hands full with these two midway in the seventh round.
Michael Dokes is very tired. He just fell in that time and grabbed Weaver. You know, when you grab like that, you're liable to catch a punch. But both hands are extended. You're not in a punching position.
There is a mouse under the left eye of Michael Weaver. That's the only mark he has to show. Dokes has had trickles of blood from his nose throughout this fight. Less than a minute to go in the seventh round now. Dokes continues to jab as he backs up.
Dokes' hands going further down all the time, and Weaver's trying to take advantage of it by nailing him a left hook in close.
Weaver playing the waiting game, and Dokes may be running out of time in terms of stamina. And right, partially blocked by Weaver. 30 seconds now to go in the round, number seven. Weaver content to stand on the ropes for the closing seconds of the seventh round. Now, good combination from Dokes as they come off the ropes. Effective punches by Michael Dokes. At the bell to end round seven.
You gotta hit him for that body.
Stay in the body, you understand?
Right.
Stay in
Mike,
the body.
Mike, you gotta let it roll now, so let me get that again.
Both of them. Start, put both of them into the body now. You're shooting all to the head. You see, Mr. Rose,
get in the water.
Hey, now put them together. Put them together. Put them together. But you gotta put them together. Up and down. Up and down. Or rather start down and up.
Johnny Taco's using the old method about putting the faces. Piece of stainless steel to work on that swelling over the left eye.
There was a good flurry by Michael Dokes late in that seventh round. Good combination scoring with him. This is a very close fight. Round number eight is underway. Bear in mind again that Michael Dokes has not gone beyond 10 rounds and will be put to a test of stamina as this fight continues.
They're using plenty of water in Michael Dokes' corner, Don. And it's completely wet there now. If anybody goes into that corner, liable to slip because it doesn't actually go into the canvas because you have insulated padding underneath.
I've got Weaver slightly ahead at this stage into the early seconds of round number eight. How about you, Angelo Dundee?
I got it very close. It's all according with the eyes of the beholder. And everybody looks at the fight differently. Aggression, the best punches, the stronger punches. You don't know. Stronger punches, Mike Weaver. Aggression, Mike Weaver. Counter punching very well, Michael Dokes.
Let me ask you this. You picked Weaver to win. Is he on the right path toward that victory as far as you're concerned?
Well, Weaver just got a cut eye. You never know in a fight. I mean, you know, everybody's got, you know, entitled to their opinion. My opinion is that Weaver would win it. He wants it more. And Michael hasn't been, you know, hitting the ball like he should as a fighter.
Now there's blood from beside the right eye of Mike Weaver. A mouse under the left we saw earlier. Now a trace of blood beside the other eye. Blood from the nostrils of Michael Dokes still evident.
That nosebleed is bothering the heck out of Michael because he's breathing from his mouth. You can
right.
See how he's sucking for air as he's going back, which is dangerous because if you got your mouth wide open, you're liable to catch a shot. Voila, cracked jaw.
We are past the midway mark of the eighth round. It is scheduled for 15, remember, WBA championship at stake. And anybody's fight to this point. Now, more evidence of blood emanating from beside the right eye of Mike Weaver. Referee trying to wrestle him apart in the final minute of this eighth round. Richard Steele has been a very diligent, alert referee, no question of that.
Michael Dokes getting hurt, Don, with those body shots. He got hit a right hand to the body, reacted kind of funny. Picked up his right leg, and I didn't like the way he reacted.
Weaver flicking out the left jab. And that cut, it would appear, is well away from the eye of Mike Weaver. There's puffiness and blood on the right side. The mouse under the left eye, but nothing that serious, it would seem.
Michael Dokes is getting hurt with those body shots. I don't like the way he reacted, the way he picked up his leg, and the way he's hanging in there. That's unnatural for a young kid.
The breathing is bothering him more and more because of the blood from the nose. You can see that now as we're down to the final 5 seconds of this, the eighth round, scheduled for 15.
U.S. Track and Field Championships. ABC's Wide World of Sports returns June 25th.
Getting ready for round nine. Between rounds, Weaver's corner worked on that cut near Mike's right eye.
The cut is not in a dangerous spot.
No.
It's under the right eye to the outside of the right eye. They're not the dangerous type. The only thing about blood, Don, Dokes sees the blood on Michael Weaver. Therefore, he figures, hey, he's got a shot to worsen the cut, you know, and end the contest a little early.
That's encouragement for him as the blood becomes evident again beside the right eye of Weaver. Again, we state it is not a serious cut at this point. But it does offer encouragement for Michael Dokes.
Don, we can easily say that the pace has not picked up, right?
It has not picked up. In fact, the only brisk pace happened in the first 30 seconds of round number one. It was Weaver, though, who flew at Dokes and was hurt a couple of times, I thought. Paid a price for it.
Dokes is grabbing in the clinches, and he's paying for it because Weaver's pulling them towards him and nailing punches. So his hand should be up in the clinches and not be catching because he's grabbing too much.
Dokes has got to be concerned about the breathing problem caused by blood from his right nostril. It's been around all fight. And, of course, the fact he has moved around in a reverse direction so much, that's got to be tiring, too. Not to mention the arm weariness he must be feeling out of this heat of a Las Vegas evening, midway in the ninth round.
I think Dokes just sustained the cut. I just saw a blood spurt. I don't know.
Maybe from the nose. more evident now than before from the right nostril of Michael Doakes. That's more of a little welt, a little slit under Weaver's eye than a dangerous cut on his part. A minute to go on the round. Doakes hanging on again.
The fatigue of Doakes is barely evident. I mean, he's grabbing, he's holding. You know, he's doing everything. No, he's
Oh, wait a minute. There is a cut now. We can see it. It's under Doakes' left eye. He takes a snapping right, counterpunching the body of Mike Weaver. But Weaver stung him with that right and comes after him to inflict more.
He just got hurt with that right hand, Don. He almost went down with it. If he'd hit him with that right hand, he'd have been down.
30 seconds to go. Risk action here in round number nine. Ducking low. Doakes rips the right. Now the left hook by Mike Weaver. 15 seconds to go on the round.
See, Weaver keep fighting his regular pace.
Steady and sure. Left hook he throws. At the bell to win round nine.
Track racing.
Round 10 underway.
The second, Bill Present did a real good job on the cut. He's a very good cut man. And you can hardly see where the cut was.
Again, neither cut serious. Weaver's right eye and Doakes' left. Weaver wades in with a body shot. The right up to the face of Michael Doakes. Then the left hand. Weaver scoring more frequently as Doakes' fatigue intensifies.
And he's looking to grab. Doakes looking to grab him when he comes in. You can't do that with a puncher like Michael Weaver, because he's got his hands free and can nail you a good punch in close. But he is the shorter puncher.
Doakes' hands getting lower and lower again. Weaver had to survive the early rounds and has done that successfully. Now, taking the fight to Doakes as we progress into this, the 10th round, scheduled for 15, the WBA championship in the heavyweight division at stake here in Las Vegas.
Now, you know, this is where you separate the men from the boys, from the 10th to the 15th round. This is going to be a tough, tough fight all the way. And I think Michael Doakes is definitely getting hurt with the punches more because he is fatigued.
Halfway in the 10th round. We thought it would either be a very short fight or a very long one, and we're certainly on the long side now. But as you saw Doakes stunned by Weaver's right back in that ninth round, you've seen Weaver hurt earlier in this fight. Either man with the capability of ending at the 4:15.
Doakes a very tired young man. He's just looking to grab and hold and rest. Doing it that way, running in with his head, he's going to get nailed with a right uppercut. Sure as God made apple.
Under a minute remaining in the 10th round. Referee Richard Steele saying, don't hold him, Doakes. That's happening more and more frequently as a tired Michael Doakes hangs on.
Doakes must be telling the referee, it's okay for you, but not for me.
Good right by Doakes there at the end of that clinch. So Doakes is dropping his hands lower and lower, but he flicks them up from his waist. The left especially effective. Weaver pushed him out, comes right after him, 20 seconds to go on the round.
Yeah, because Doakes is falling in and grabbing him, Don. And that's what he's trying to do. So Weaver's getting a little rough in there himself.
Just 5 seconds to go on the 10th round. So for Doakes, he's heading into overtime in the 11th round. Takes a good shot at the bell to end round number 10.
A reason.
Back for more of Doakes and Weaver.
Oh,
As we get ready for round 11, this 90-degree heat, Angelo, is taking its toll more on Dopes than Weaver, I suspect.
Well, when you're that young, Don, you never know what you can do, your own capabilities, because you can suck it up and really let it all hang out, because youth covers a lot of ill things you do in boxing.
Weaver has 12, 13, 15 round experience in the heavyweight division, but Dilks has not gone this far in his career before the 11th round. Neither man terribly active the last couple of years either. But the conditioning of Weaver beginning to pay off here as this fight progresses now into an 11th round. Dilks starting to circle the ring a great deal more than he was earlier and put that jab out more effectively than we saw previously in this fight. Although the fact that Weaver was the underdog at 4-1 in some circles, Angelo, before the fight, you called Mike Weaver to win this.
I'm looking at it as, you know, a professional standpoint. I knew Mike Weaver was hitting the ball. I know Michael Dilks wasn't doing what he's supposed to be doing, because you cannot train and keep late hours. You cannot train and trying to do everything but train. You got to do one thing.
Weaver rips the left hand to stop the dancing of Dilks. Dilks leans in on him now.
Dilks is dancing without direction. I mean, you're dancing
aimlessly.
Aimless, no reason. I mean, you got to dance and then let a shot go and get out of there. That was a good move.
Get up at his toes and rip the left hand to Weaver. Yeah, the Weaver jab, the left hand being flicked out. Missing with a lunging right hand.
See, Michael's got to stop Weaver from coming in like he's doing. Now, I don't know if the guys in the corner are going to give him the stool in the next round, because he's not doing nothing to keep Mike Weaver off.
Jab, jab, that's Weaver's policy, as he is the aggressor pursuing Michael Dilks around this Las Vegas ring.
Think about Mike Weaver, he's not even breathing. He's just breathing nice and easy, steady pace.
A lot of the jabs that Dilks is throwing in a counter-punching sense are back at his heels. They haven't got all that much sting to them because he's been in reverse gear almost since the second round. Less than 30 seconds to go, and this is the 11th round.
No fight's never won till the final tabulations. I'm a firm believer of that. He's got to win it decisively, Mike Weaver, because you just can't sit back and say, hey, I'm winning the fight. He's going to win the fight, because it never happens that way.
That's what a challenger always has to do, as Weaver mistimed that punch and lunged into the ropes. He wants to throw the champion. It better be decisive. He wants the judge's attention. That'll do it for the 11th round.
It's not.
12th round underway.
Don, the corner instruction of Weaver was excellent. Don Manuel told him, don't load up. Let your shots go. You're not cutting them off. You got to back them up. You're making them go round the circle. You got to cut the guy off. Let your shots go. Don't load up. Don't look for one big punch.
Good right by Dilks there at the end of that exchange, as Weaver sends a long blow, marginally low, to the midsection of Michael Dilks.
Body shots definitely hurting Michael Dilks. That left hip he hit him was like a liver shot, and that really took the legs out from underneath of Michael Dilks.
Particularly at this stage, the 12th round of a fight. We repeat that Dilks has never gone this long in his professional career. Just 24, the experienced Mike Weaver at 30. Knows what he has to do here in the late going.
I think Mike Weaver's going to wait. As soon as Michael Dilks slaps his head, he's going to nail him with a left uppercut. But Michael's putting his head right out there for him to nail. And it's a cardinal sin. Never put your head first, your hands first.
A little less spring in the step of Michael Dilks again in this 12th round.
And he's getting a little sluggish. Getting
good
a little sluggish
now.
Down.
let's face it, Weaver's got to be tiring too, but he's in far better condition.
I think, Don, you're the boxing expert. It just happened. I seen where Weaver was slowing up.
And he caught a couple of good shots there, the left and the right from Michael Dokes. I don't care who you are, what shape you're in, you got to be tired after a bruising battle like this into the 12th round.
Especially under these conditions. The heat's got to take its toll on the fighters. They're sweating profusely. They come in sweating, and therefore, they can't. All the water going out of their body. You and I both know there's plenty of liquid in your systems, but it takes a lot of strength away from you also.
Well, the guy lost half a gallon out here in the sun this afternoon. Not humid, but very, very hot. Less than 30 seconds to go in this 12th round. Low blow, it appeared, from Weaver. Steele saying, you guys, step back. Listen to me, will you? He's earning his pay, the referee. Less than 5 seconds to go on the 12th round. Combination at the bell by Michael Dokes.
It takes more than a single
command.
Mike Dokes was getting very arm weary. He had his special trainer come into the ring. I don't know who the guy is, but he's a massage guy because he was rubbing his arms furiously. He's really getting arm weary. He can't get his arms up.
A new experience for him. Into a 13th round now. I have Weaver ahead of this stage, ever so slightly, and I think if he can hold and continue to do what he has done the last five or six rounds, he'll be all right. I think that Dokes has got to do something rather spectacular here to make sure of this win. Angela, how do you feel about it?
I feel it's a very close fight myself. I think these next three rounds will very well can tell the winner this fight. I think Weaver's slightly ahead.
Those earlier cuts of no consequence now.
You notice that? The way the foot grabbed that time on that lead in the middle, that Budweiser sign. They painted that sign with lead paint, and every time the guys try to slide forward, their feet will grab. And that just happened to Mike Weaver. Body shots are really taking their toll on Michael Dokes. He just got nailed a couple of good body shots, a left hook and a right hand to the body. And he's really sucking for wind again. And he's really blowing.
A key point you made earlier, the body shots, the most telling of all, the most wearing of all, into the late rounds of a fight such as this. Caution for holding from the referee, Richard Steele, to Michael Dokes. Snapping left hand thrown out. Now a good body shot thrown by Michael Weaver as Dokes retaliates, counter-punching off the ropes and leaning into him.
Michael really got hurt with those shots that time. And really, he can't even get his hands up, the poor kid. And if he gets dropped this round, it wouldn't surprise me, Don.
He's got a little over a minute to get through this 13th round. Dokes very arm-weary now. Had to wait a long time in arriving. Not much snap to his punches, but he's got hard. He continues to throw at Weaver, who continues to keep coming after him.
Richard's saying, watch your head, because poor Michael Dokes is going in and trying to grab, that's all, with the head first.
He's coming in low all the time with it. Less than 30 seconds remaining in the 13th round. Both men have been hurt, but not down.
Notice Michael Weaver still keeps the same pace, slow.
Just a few seconds left in this, the 13th round. Two to go to decide this championship.
Sure, I'd like to get rid of some of...
Weaver is on his feet, ready for the 14th round. Doak slowly coming off his stool. A hot night in Las Vegas. Between rounds, Weaver's corner Angelo had advice about the sun problem here.
Johnny Tacco is trying to keep him facing the sun, but there's no sun out there, actually, to bother anybody.
Very low now.
The best thing Tacco said was, hit him in the belly. And he did a good job on the guy's cut. Because the body shots are taking his toll on Michael Doak. And you know what the old story is, the body don't move, the head does.
Ripping left hand made contact from Mike Weaver that time.
Best shot was the body shot. He missed the left hook, the right hand. The left hook to the body landed.
And that back dokes up all the more. Actually, Doak's, considering the fact that he is a little soft on conditioning, you can see that, is doing very well. Hanging in here.
Doak's has got nothing. Doak's is fighting on guts, courage that he's got plenty of.
A lot of it.
And he has nothing in there, actually. No sting, no bounce, no nothing.
There certainly isn't much sting. Those punches coming from a retreating position off his heel, not having much effect. But they're scoring blows when he lands them. Weaver there lashing out the left again, missing with the right hand.
Weaver's making the mistake of looking for one punch. Should go underneath like he's doing there. Really dig down because that's the shot he's hurting him with.
Midway on the 14th. The body punches have certainly
Doak.
He wades in again with the left, follows with the right to the head.
Mike Weaver's literally running at the guy to get the shots. And Doak's is smart enough to wrap him up and tie him up because otherwise you're going to catch those shots downstairs.
There he grabs him again. A little over a minute to go on the 14th.
Yeah, Michael Doak's is really hurting in there. Every shot he's getting hit right now is hurting him.
Doak's reaching down for a reserve of second wind that has been a long time in coming, and he hasn't found it yet.
And boxing is no extra gas tank. You can't cover up. You got to go in there completely conditioned.
Again, leaning in on Mike Weaver. That's about all he can do, is the crowd now booing him a little bit for that. The man is exhausted. Less than 30 seconds to go in the 14th round. And the judges have to be impressed with the freshness of Weaver, the crispness, and the fact that Doak's is hanging on a lot of these later rounds.
Doak's is actually grabbing and putting his arm down to his side so he won't get hurt with those body shots.
Trying to protect himself there, but a couple have gotten through. There's the bell. The 14th round is over.
The scorecards of judges Letterman and Hazard even after 14 rounds. The 15th and final round would then decide the fight. Let's go back to the ring.
Doak's on his stool, getting up slowly as the 15th round is underway. Good left thrown early by Weaver. Doak's trying to find some energy to throw those four punches to one, his corner urged him to do.
Weaver's going to try to keep him busy, busy, busy. Doak's is going to try to flurry and keep out of danger.
Weaver appears to be leading here. But remember, when he was behind a Johnny Tate, had to have a knockout to win in the 15th round. He got one. He looks every bit as fresh here. These two look like they're back in round one right now.
And Weaver's a puncher, pure puncher, and if you get a shot in there, you'll have to see Doak's go down.
And I would think that Doak's needs the big knockout punch if he's going to hold on to his title here in the 15th.
Yeah, Doak's has definitely got a hold on, but he's going to fall down because completely exhausted. That he's staying up.
Chopping right. Now the left to the body. A telling blow by Mike Weaver. Raining punches all over Doak's. There's the right to the side of the head by Weaver. Doak's not faring well in this exchange. Wildly missing now.
If I were Weaver, Don, I wouldn't be gambling like that.
Nope.
Cover up. Let your body shots go. Forget about gambling.
I think he may have it wide. He can afford to perhaps go into a conservative shell now rather than risk what he's doing at the present time.
I'll tell you, the heads have been coming into play. Weaver has a big hematoma over his right eye. He's very lucky this is the 15th round.
Halfway through it. Michael Dokes with a big, big heart. Game as can be, going now five rounds longer than he ever has before, trying to hang on to his title.
I'm surprised that Dokes doesn't have a big lump on his head because it's strictly a clash of heads. And that hematoma over Mike Weaver's right eye is a very bad thing, and he's very lucky it is the 15th round.
Time on his side now, not on Dokes.
Swelling over the right eye caused by budding. It's like the blood rushing into one spot over the eye.
Surprised we haven't seen it before now, the way their heads have been coming together. Wow, chanting Weaver.
Also, the big lump created when you blow your nose because the air gets under the tissues and this causes the swelling.
Referee slept almost caught in the middle of that exchange. 25 seconds to go in the fight. The WBA championship at stake. And it looks now as though indeed, after the early knockout and the fight being stopped, it will go the distance. A tremendous punishment taken by Dokes there from Weaver. A good right by Dokes in retaliation. These two are going to go at it right down to the final seconds of the 15th and final round. And it has gone the distance. It'll be in the hands now of the three judges, Hiram Letterman, Larry Hazard, and Jerry Roth, to decide whether Michael Weaver has regained the championship or Michael Dokes gets to keep the crown he won.
As you have seen, Letterman and Hazard scored round 15 even, and therefore both had the fight a draw. Their decision overruled the third judge, who scored Dokes the winner, and the fight was ruled a draw by majority decision, the first time in 70 years that a heavyweight title fight had been declared. A draw in a championship fight means that the champion keeps his title, so Michael Dokes retained his WBA World Heavyweight crown, and Don Chevrier spoke to him immediately following the announcement of the decision.
I know I wasn't tired, but he was...
You weren't tired?
He was relentless. He was as tired as I was, you know? If you look at him... If you get him to the mic, you'll see where he has several lacerations over both eyes. His forehead is swollen on both sides. I hit him with the most devastating punches.
You never thought you were running out of gas because you had the breathing problem with the blood around the nose from early on.
No, I wasn't. It took a little bit of time. I hurt my left hand in about the third or fourth round, and I really couldn't get my momentum going and my flow, the movement with me. So it was kind of hard for me to... really maintain things.
In the press conference following that interview, Michael Dokes said that he would not fight Mike Weaver again. Don Chevrier then spoke with Mike Weaver.
I felt that I wouldn't fight because I did all the fighting and the pressure. Dokes did all the running and the holding and the thumbing and the hitting low. You know, I felt I wouldn't fight.
How do you feel when he says he won't fight you again?
Well, I expected it because he know he didn't win the fight. He know I gave him a toughest fight of his career, and he know he don't want to take the chance fighting me again. So I don't expect him to give me a rematch. I'm going to have to fight and hope I get one from somebody.
A lot of us at ringside thought you won. You obviously felt you won as well.
Yes, I felt I won. But somehow I seem to cannot beat the system.
Championship. One of the most distinguished and most popular of all boxing champions today, from Coral Gables, Florida, now coming into the ring is Alexis Arguello, taking it.
Former Olympian and Lexus lightweight James Bubba.
Appreciative of applause here. Referee is Octavio Mayron from Mexico. He will not figure in the scoring. That will be done by three judges at ringside. Mike Jacobs from Great Britain. Jose Mayorca from San Francisco, formerly from Nicaragua. And Alan Spider Bynum from Dallas, Texas. The challenger in blue with white trim, the champion in dark green velvet. We know the challenger, Buscemi, has very quick hands. He's a southpaw. Arguello, while bothered somewhat by southpaws, has been very successful against them. Indeed, in his last 11 fights, he has faced five of them and knocked out four of those five. Joe, we have been watching these two fighters in the gym this week. as this first round develops, perhaps you can describe the pros and cons of Buscemi's southpaw style.
Well, Buscemi is a southpaw, Tim, but he doesn't take advantage of the fact that he's a southpaw because he does not circle as much to his right as he should. What we've been watching him do in training is he throw a combination and move right into right hands, and he had better not do that with Arguello or it could be fatal.
Arguello, on the other hand, does not normally attack the left-hander as well as he does a right-hander, but if Buscemi does move to his left, he'll be helping the champion. The combination scored by Buscemi, and naturally getting a rise from the crowd.
Now you notice Buscemi is moving to his left, which is unusual for a southpaw. He's moving right into Arguello's right hand.
He does not look comfortable moving the other way when we watch him work out, which is unusual, but it just appears to be easier for him to go to his left.
Tim, he likes to throw punches, and he has very, very fast hands, but he's a singles hitter, and Arguello is a home run hitter, and that could prove to be the big difference in the fight as the fight progresses.
And 27 victories, but he has not been in there against real strong opposition, with the exception of Herman Monte and the Mexican Beto Ramos. Under a minute to go, round one. Left hand lands, a straight left hand, perhaps his best punch. Arguello making his 18th title defense.
Tim, that right hand was set up by a beautiful left hook to the body. That is the combination to use against the southpaw. Beautiful combination.
25 seconds remaining in round one. Scheduled 15-round WBC lightweight championship bout. The champion, Alexis Arguello, on the left of your screen, on the foreground in green. Bubba Buscemi from Beaumont, Texas, at the top of your screen, the challenger. When asked about the crowd, he said, "I expect I'll get positive vibrations from him." And he lands the left jab, backing up Arguello. But he said in the Herman Montes fight, they were all chanting, "Bubba, Bubba, Bubba."
It could be a negative factor if he gets carried away and tries to trade punches with Arguello. That could be a big mistake. He has to stick to his battle plan for 15 rounds and don't make any mistakes, which is tough to do over the long haul.
In his Texas title fight, he's gone 12 rounds twice. He says he is ready to go 15 if necessary, and he tries to win one round at a time. Very firm about that. He said, "My object is to win each round. I don't worry about the knockout. Want to win each round." That right hand, just the left hand, pardon me, just fell short. Arguello stinging Buscemi with a jab. Very patient work of the champion, as always, cutting off the ring.
Bubba Buscemi had a great amateur background, Tim, but when he went to the old veteran, Hugh Benbow, Benbow went right back to work on his fundamentals. He said he wasn't keeping his hands high enough. He taught him to keep his hands up and to throw every punch correct. That is according to what Hugh Benbow told us.
Benbow took over in November of last year. Good left hand landed from Buscemi. He has had Buscemi for the last 11 fights. He's won them all. Another left hand in the ear of the champion Arguello from Buscemi. Under a minute to go. Round two and a right hand from the champion Arguello. From professional boxing for nearly 4 years, after winning four Golden Gloves championships, national championships from 1969 to 72, he was on the 72 Olympic team, won a bronze medal.
Arguello's starting to get his distance a little bit now, Tim. He's starting to really put pressure on Buscemi. It's early in the fight.
Less than 30 seconds to go in round two. Thank you. 3, Tim Ryan and Gil Clancy live from Beaumont, Texas. 6,618 fans and probably a few more jammed in here to the Civic Center to watch the local hero, Bubba Buscemi, challenge for the world crown. The champion, Arguello, on the left of your screen in green.
Well, Buscemi's punches have any effect at all, Tim. He's going to have to maneuver Arguello way out of position and then try to step in with a punch. Right now, his punches are almost like taps. Even though they're landing, they're just taps.
Going with that right jab, Buscemi. Buscemi dedicated this fight to Babe Diddick and Zaharias. And the left hand. He was born and raised in Beaumont. There's a big memorial tour here, the late great athlete. And Buscemi started his boxing career as an amateur in the elementary school that Babe Zaharias attended as a child. He has a sense of history, 30-year-old Buscemi. Left hand from the champion landed.
Good left hook, it hurt Buscemi too.
Buscemi battles back and scores a combination on our way of guys. I'd like to alert our local stations along the line. At the end of this round, we'll take a 30-second station break. Combination from Buscemi scores.
The big punch is missed, and the right jab scores, but the big punch is missed.
Buscemi trains himself, but he has his father, Jim Buscemi Sr., working in his corner as a cut man. His manager, Hugh Benbo, is in there as well. He's 78-year-old boxing legend from Texas, former fighter, manager, promoter, $8 million in oil and land, and now back in the boxing business. Under a minute to go.
Very fast-paced fight. Very fast-paced.
Big left hook
by Arguello. Big left hook.
That one staggered Buscemi momentarily. Realized his legs under him.
In training, they told Arguello to go to the body first and then to the head, but so far, except for that right hand, it's been all head.
Combination scores from the champion. Under 30 seconds to go in the third round. Championship fight will continue after this word from your local station. In Colorado, cover the Giant Slalom Women's event. This is round number 4. Alexis Arguello and Bubba Buscemi. And Buscemi just missed that left hand, but he did back up the champion Arguello.
Tim, he hasn't hit Alex with a solid left hand yet. For him to slow Arguello down a little bit, he's going to have to nail him with a good solid left hand. He hasn't landed one yet.
Some kind of a warning there from the referee, Mayron. I'm not sure what that meant. I'm not sure the fighter knew either.
Looked to me like safe at first.
Octavio Mayron from Mexico, the non-scoring referee. Arguello stalking his prey in his familiar fashion. Slowly going forward, cutting off the ring. Buscemi seemingly much more aware of him, and he just raised him on the right hand. That landed twice, this would have been all over. Buscemi, but no damage done, despite the roar of the crowd.
He still hasn't landed a good, solid, straight left hand, as we saw him do in training so often. He's a little tight.
Again, we'd like to alert our local stations along the line. At the end of this round, we'll take another 30-second station break. Buscemi missing with a combination. 29-year-old Alexis Arguello, he'll be 30 in April. Buscemi will be 30 tomorrow. Right hand just grazed the cheekbone of Buscemi.
That left hand falls short every time.
Go.
That was probably his best left hand of the fight, then.
The man continually keep coming at you, though, even after you land or something.
Coming out like an express train.
Gray-haired man, still in the corner there, the manager, Bubba Buscemi, giving him some instructions as he is continuing his challenge here against Alexis Arguello on the left of your screen. We scored the last round for Buscemi, a close round, but we went his way with it. The champion continues to exert control just by his position in the ring, continually cutting off Buscemi, and there's a little less movement from Buscemi than we expected, Gil.
Well, Tim, we said he had the fast hands and he was a southpaw, but he likes to punch himself, so he's always looking to punch. He's not looking so much to get out of the way there. There he comes again. I'm surprised that Alexis doesn't stand there, block a punch, and counter, but when Buscemi attacks him, he backs up.
Buscemi scored with a left in that last exchange.
Trouble figuring Buscemi out. Every time he gets set to the punch, Buscemi beats him to the punch and gets out of there the way he should. He just did it again.
Arguello just missed with a big overhand right palm. Landed the left hook. The crowd roaring with every punch. There's a big right hand by Arguello. Knocks Buscemi into the rope.
When he gets hit, he fights back, Tim.
Yes, he does. Three times.
Starting to breathe a little heavy now, though, Tim Buscemi. Breathing good amount. That's a sign that he's getting tired.
Under a minute to go, round five. Crowd scanning. Baba, baba. Taping along the rope.
This is a hard fight to score, Tim. Buscemi's landing a lot of taps, and Arguello's landing a solid punches.
He just landed a straight right hand, the champion did. Coming to the end of this fifth round with a left hook landed by the champion again. Round six from Beaumont, Texas, Tim Ryan and Joe Clancy. The challenger, Bubba Buscemi, with a slight swelling under his right eye that received attention between rounds. The champion on the right of your screen, Alexis Arguello, defending his lightweight title for the third time. He's been the featherweight, super featherweight, and lightweight champion. Good right hand from the challenger, Buscemi. And a combination back. And another left hook and a right hand with Arguello. Effectively over there. This combination was landed by the champion. Those are the damaging blows. Credit to Buscemi. He does punch back as he gets hit.
Well, we mentioned his mouth was open, and he's starting to get a little tired. Arguello is really putting pressure on
him. Buscemi short again with his punches. Arguello going to the body.
It's amazing that Buscemi has missed so many of those straight left hands because he sets Arguello up, and then when he throws it, he misses it.
And Arguello is right there. You don't have to look for him.
Right. Jamie has proved he can take a punch, Jim, because he got hit with some good solid shots this round.
The left of Arguello, under a minute to go. Left hook, dagger goes Jamie. He's hurt. A short left hook. Dagger goes Jamie. And another left hand land.
Tag it again.
That buckle is free. Arguello sensing the opportunity to put him away. Another left hook. And a right hand, Jamie won't go down. Stop the fight. Arguello has won by the referee stopping this fight without Buscemi going to the canvas, but he is out on his feet here in round number six. Let's take a look at that sequence.
Those left hooks did the job, didn't that first left hook put him on Queer Street. He didn't know where he was after that. It was just the fact that he had that fighting heart and he knew enough to throw punches back when he was hurt. He didn't know where he was at all. But look at him still trying to throw punches. Out on his feet and still trying to throw punches.
Alexis Arguello, knowing that the fight is over, must be very surprised that this young man has not gone down. He's still on his feet when the referee, Mayron, jumps in. And
maybe you can tell us what happened.
It was a left hook to the jaws. And then they have to be a fighter. To have to see the chance, you have to use your hands to use the situation, you know, and you have to be like a hawk one time by say, like a hawk to see the special moment to attack.
Were you surprised that he didn't go down?
Well, I'm surprised because I...
Bubba, you did a great job. I think your fans here still love you from what we gather.
Oh, yeah.
You were determined to stay on your feet, weren't you?
Yes, I was, Tim. I'm not the guy that's going to quit, you know. And I wanted to stay in here because I thought the fight wasn't that, you know, I didn't think he was that far ahead of me up until then. But he caught me with some good shots, and Alexis is a great champion.
And there weren't any surprises for you in there then, huh?
No, well, I think he was a little faster than I thought he was going to be. But, you know, like I say, he's a great champion.
All right, Bubba, great job. We appreciate your great performance here this afternoon. The Texas champion.
The former World Boxing Association.
Todos aplaudiendo. De arriba hasta abajo, por todas partes. Y Ciro Doman continúa ahí dándole indicaciones de todo tipo, moviendo los brazos de un lado, la operación de toda clase de mímicas. Ahora se está dando visitas frente a él. Y lo mismo está haciendo Riasco, que está acompañado del señor Estado. Aparece como seco en el lado abajo, por el campeón mundial. Los dos boxeadores están siendo llevados por sus seconds al centro. Los dos elegantemente se tocan los guantes y ahora Fermi Carpentier le está explicando, como diríamos en béisbol, la ley del terreno. Así es, pues, que con toda seguridad les dice, tienen que pelear cada instante que tengan a pelear limpiamente. Saber mantener la guardia bien alta, olvidarse de los golpes bajos, no cabecear y a dar un gran show para todo el público. Usualmente se despide con una palmadita fraternal en las espaldas de los boxeadores. Una cosa muy interesante que yo he visto en el boxeo, cuando están haciendo esta pequeña ceremonia, algunos de los seconds comienzan a tocar la nuca de los boxeadores, como está haciendo Dosman con Alexis, como que estuviera tocando piano. Esto está por comenzar. Boxeo. estos momentos que suene la campana. Sopla una brisa fresca proveniente del lago de Nicaragua. Carlos con el centro y está a punto de llamarlo. Es el bato. Y esto ya va a comenzar. Este es el primer round de la pelea por el campeonato mundial. Acercándose ahora los dos. Primer round está comenzando. Los dos en el centro comienzan a bailotear. Con más rapidez, Riasco de Panamá. El campeón mundial tira un jab de izquierda, se queda corto. Otro de Riasco, se queda corto también. Ahora uno de Alex se pasa refinando los guantes. Bonita izquierda de Riasco y se sale rápido. Una izquierda ahora del campeón mundial y no la puede colocar. Una derecha un poco rara del retador y no la conecta. Están bailoteando los dos, tratando de conocerse bien. Amenaza con izquierda a Alexis, pero no la dispara. Ahora tira una, pero no la desarrolla toda. Contesta Riasco en los guantes de Alexis. Una izquierda por debajo, logra conectarla en el estómago de Alexis. Ahora tira una izquierda el retador y nada, otra y tampoco. Amenaza con la derecha Alexis, pero no la desarrolla del todo. Una izquierda de Riasco y se queda corto. Una derecha fuerte del campeón, pero pega en los guantes. Una izquierda muy bonita de Riasco a la cara del campeón. Ya lo conectaron por primera vez. Tira un jab de izquierda el campeón y se queda corto. Una izquierda de Alexis, pasa refilando nada más. Una recta bien bonita del retador Riasco. El campeón arremete, tira un gancho de izquierda, remata con uno de derecho, lo conecta bien, conecta muy bien con la izquierda, ahora Riasco va a regresar. Cayeron en el frente rápidamente y se separaron. Izquierda bonita de Riasco, qué bien que la está conectando. Otra izquierda de Riasco, y las dos han sido conectadas a Alexis. Ahora Alexis, un gancho bien bonito, están en el frente los dos, pero se separan rápidamente. Una izquierda de Riasco, falla. Dos izquierdas y acaban de fallar. Un gancho tremendo de Alexis. Conectó un gancho de Alexis bien bonito. Ahora tira dos izquierdas a Alexis, las dos la conecta. Cayeron a Alexis los dos. Y lo separa Carpentier. Ahora una derecha de Riasco y la acaba de fallar. Tirando los dos, la acaban de fallar. Una izquierda de Riasco y la falla de nuevo. Ahora trata de tirar un gancho a Alexis y lo acaba de fallar. Tanto en el punto y el boxeo también. Una izquierda bonita de refilón, una derecha ahora de Riasco. Ahora en izquierda del campeón mundial, tira otra izquierda Alexis. Todo parece indicar que Alexis está llevando ligeramente el tren de ataque. No hemos visto. ¡Una izquierda de Alexis! ¡Otra izquierda! ¡Fuera con la izquierda de Alexis! ¡Una izquierda de Alexis! El Riasco se aprovecha y lo agarra. Con izquierda de Alexis. Y cada uno que el boxeo y los está separando. Y terminó el primer. Al retador, el retador hasta ahora está saliendo. Ahí los tenemos a los dos. Izquierda bonita de Alexis. Ahora un guante bien bonito de Alexis. Con la izquierda de Riasco. Alexis está remetiendo fuertemente, tira dos izquierdas, la conecta a las dos, y la lleva hasta la cuerda, pero parece que se repone Riasco. Un gancho bonito de Riasco. El campeón ha hecho una buena remetida al comenzar el segundo round. Ahora una izquierda que acaba de fallar. Riasco de Panamá. Ustedes pueden ver bien de que el campeón lleva el tren de ataque. Pero está esperando ahora, tratando de buscar el hoyo. Riasco trata de conectar abajo muchas veces. Bonita izquierda, pero casi pierde el balance Riasco. Están en el clinch y trata de golpear por debajo, han sido separados. ahora tira una izquierda que se quedó corto, ahora una derecha, y esta derecha algunas veces lo hace perder el balance. Pero Alexis tira ahora una izquierda y contesta con una izquierda bien bonita. Riasco, entran los dos en el 1-2 y los dos se castigan. Una derecha bonita del campeón, bien conectada. Ahora la derecha, ahora izquierda del campeón. Ahora se agarra de los brazos del campeón. Cayó las cuerdas y se regresó por el impulso de ellas mismas. Una derecha del campeón falla. Vamos a ver qué tal lo hace ahora. Tiene una derecha, pero está completamente groggy. Riasco, derecha linda. Cierra y lo están deteniendo. Por el impulso de ellas mismas. Una derecha del campeón falla. Vamos a ver qué tal lo hace ahora. Tiene una derecha, pero está completamente groggy. Riasco, derecha linda. Y lo están deteniendo. Y lo dejaron ganador de la pelea. Ganador de la pelea. His dream born.
Norris is wasting no time. They're short, they're businesslike, they're right on the money, and right now there's a very apprehensive look on the face of Blocker, who's tasted that real power of, look at that, whoa!
Whoa, what a thump as Blocker hits the canvas!
Four!
That's what he was doing. And that's the look he had. I'm going to get hit.
Eight! Give me a glove.
Richard Steele going to have a job on his hands because Norris is a finisher.
Norris trying to polish Blocker off in the final 40 seconds of the first round. Good left hand by Norris above us.
Blocker doesn't even know where he